Hi everyone, welcome back to Edureka, instructor-led training portal. So in our previous classes, we were looking into the different controls of Selenium and how to create the PaLM classes based on the web pages and the application, right? So in our today's class, we are going to talk about another important tool, which is, you know, configured with your Selenium, which is your TestNG tool. So what is this TestNG? Why we are going to use this TestNG? What are the operations that we are going to perform using this TestNG? And what flexibility and benefits we are going to get when we use this TestNG is what we are going to understand in our today's session, right? So we have already set our objectives. So this is going to be our agenda today. So after completing this module, you should be able to understand the purpose of TestNG, why TestNG, install TestNG plugin and in your Eclipse and work with them. In the benefits of TestNG, here we are going to understand the different annotations that is present and how to group test scripts based on any requirement is what we are going to see, along with which we are going to sequence the test cases that is returned in your TestNG, and I mean to say in your Selenium, and we are going to see how to parameterize the different browsers. That is, here we are going to send parameters and we are going to perform parallel testing using your TestNG. And also we are going to see how reports get generated and which are the reports that we are going to share with our stakeholders. So this is going to be our agenda for today's class, right? So now we are going to start with why TestNG, what is TestNG? So we have seen till now when we use your Selenium WebDriver, so we don't generate any kind of reports, right? So we don't generate reports. We are not going to share anything with our stakeholders apart from the execution that we are going to do. So when combined with TestNG, it is able to generate your reports properly in the formatted in a formatted way, right? For example, when you just share the reports to your stakeholders like your clients, they don't bother about what are the test cases that you have run, and they don't bother about the test cases that you have in your Excel sheet and whether you have marked it passed or failed or skipped or whatever. But all they want is just a simple report which talks about the entire automation flow, the execution flow, right? So that is achieved using your TestNG. So it overcomes the limitation of another framework, which is your JUnit. So before we talk about this TestNG, there was a very old unit testing tool. Your TestNG is nothing but your test next generation. So it is going to rule out all the prior available tools which were used for unit testing, like your JUnit, one of them. So this is used by developers to perform unit testing, and it is also used by automation team now to run all the automation scripts and also to generate the result set. So that is the reason we are going to use your TestNG. So now your JUnit had provided the platform to perform your unit testing, but it had a drawback that it was not available or it was not possible for your JUnit to generate reports. So the advancement was done. This is not an extension of JUnit, but instead another tool which is introduced in the market from the idea of your JUnit with the addition of your reporting as well, right? So this plugin is available in your Eclipse itself. You can go ahead and directly install it in your Eclipse. So we are going to see the way how to install your TestNG on your Eclipse. So if we go to help, here we go to help, and there's something called as Eclipse Marketplace. Just go to Eclipse Marketplace. So when you launch this Eclipse Marketplace, you will have the search tool where you can search for any plugins that is available for your Eclipse. So now I type TestNG and I just start searching, right? So once you start searching, you will get different tools which are used for this particular unit testing purpose, okay, along with your TestNG as well. So we'll see. So it is going to take time because it has to search for the entire marketplace. Can you see here? You have something something called as JUnit as well, and you have something called as TestNG for Eclipse. I've already installed it on my Eclipse, so it says installed. So for you guys, when you're starting it for the first time, you're going to get a button like this. All you have to do is just click on install, right? Once you click on install, it is going to enable this install now button. Just click on this install now button. It automatically gets installed on your Eclipse, and then click on finish. So once you click on finish, it is going to install it completely on your Eclipse. So just by installing your TestNG, you will still not be able to work with the benefits of your TestNG. So there are two more steps that we'll have to follow apart from installing your TestNG. Is first, we are going to convert our project into TestNG product, and then we are going to add the TestNG libraries into our project that we have converted, right? So I'm not going to use this particular Selenium project. Instead, I'm going to create another project, okay? So there's no harm that I can convert this as well into a TestNG project. So we have to keep one thing in mind. You cannot directly create a TestNG project. So in order to use your TestNG in your Eclipse, the first thing that you'll have to do is create a Java project, and then you will have to convert it into your TestNG project. So how do we do it? We just go to this project, right click. Okay, once you install your TestNG, there will be an option called as TestNG on your Eclipse. Okay, can you see here? There's something called as TestNG. So here you say convert to TestNG. Under TestNG, you get two different options. One is create TestNG class. The second one is convert to TestNG. So this create TestNG class will create a class with whatever name you provide, but it will contain an annotation, which means it is going to create a testable class. So we are going to understand what is a testable class later. So for now, we are going to convert this project into TestNG. So once I click on this TestNG, it generates a testng.xml file automatically. So here there are three options. One is your location where the testng.xml file should get created. So it should get created under your project. So I leave it as it is. The second one is your suit name. Suit is nothing but your project. Okay. So here you can either leave it the same or you can change it. So here I'm going to change it as Selenium project. Okay. Then your test name is any name that you want to give. So for example, say if you're performing your regression test, if you're performing your smoke test, so anything for that matter, you can provide that. So here I'm going to let it be the same way. All right. So whatever changes you make here will get reflected in your preview, column, right? So this particular place gets modified based on whatever values you pass here. So now once you're done, just click on next. So it says the refactoring does not change any source code. So no problem. We don't want to change anything. So we are just clicking on your finish button. So once you click on finish button, if you can see, there is a testng.xml file which has got created. So just double click on that. So this is nothing but an XML file. XML is nothing but extensible markup language. So we have to go to source here. So this XML file will allow you to create the tags of your own, and you can start working with those tags, right? So if you go here, so it has your suit name, it has your test, and it has your closing tags, right? So now what we are going to do is we are supposed to add the library, that is your TestNG library, to your project, right? So there are two different libraries we have. One is your JRE system library, which we got when we created our Java project by itself, right? The second one is the referenced library, which is the external libraries that we are referencing in our Eclipse, in our project. So that library is nothing but your Selenium standalone jar file, which we added. Now we are going to create, or we are going to add another library. So for that, you'll have to go to your project, right click anywhere on the project, go to your build path. So here you say configure build path. So once you say configure build path, click on add library. So in your add library, you have something called as TestNG. Just click on next and then click on finish. right? So once you finish, another library got added here. So you can say apply and close, right? As soon as you close your window, once you apply the changes and you close, you can see another library which has got added to your project, and that is nothing but your TestNG library. So this is all about the configuration of your TestNG onto your project, right? So what all we did, we installed TestNG plugin to our Eclipse, after which we converted our Java project into the TestNG project, which automatically creates your testng.xml file, after which we have added your TestNG library to our project. So now our project is ready to work with your TestNG as well. So how do we start working with your TestNG? So on the existing, if you want, I'll continue with the same. So let's continue with the same. Why to create another project? So now what we are going to do is we are going to create another package. Here I'm going to say create new package. So here I will call it as TestNG package. Just click on finish. Now what we are going to do is we are going to start working with your TestNG classes, right? So how do we work with your TestNG classes? We are going to just create some methods, right? Random methods we are going to create. So let me start creating classes. So I just say class. I'm going to say demo. Okay, you can talk about and you can give any name. So from now onwards, one important point that we'll have to keep in mind is we are not going to use your public static void main string args at any point in time in our TestNG project. Why? Because your TestNG has its own annotations which will help you to execute your methods with a lot of flexibility. So that is what we are going to see in our today's session. All right, so now what we are going to do is let me create a class called demo a. Okay, so now when I say this, I am going to just print. Okay, I'm just going to print. I'm going to create a method first, public void. I'm going to call it as demo method. Okay, now what I'm going to do, I'm going to just add one statement here. Okay, so let me say system.out.println. So you are working with TestNG, right? So this is what I'm going to print. So now, how do I run this? If you just save this, right click, run as, you think it works? No. Why? Because there's no main method as well. At the same time, we are not running it using your TestNG as well. So if you want to make this executable, if you want to execute this method, there is one important annotation that you'll have to use from your TestNG, which is your @test annotation. All right. So this @test annotation is used to execute any methods in your class, right? So wait a minute. So it is getting imported from your TestNG. I don't want it to import from TestNG. Instead, I'm going to go use your TestNG annotations, right? You'll have to always import this from org.testng.annotations and whatever the annotation that you want to download. Right, so this any method which is annotated with your @test is called as a test method, right? Your @test annotation is added to any method if you want that method to get executed, and any method that is annotated with your @test is known as your tester. So this is when you start executing your classes, right? So if I now run click on this run as, it is going to call it as run as TestNG test, right? So how do we run this class is you will have to go to your testng.xml file. Okay, there are two ways of running. One, if you want to execute just this particular class, you can directly run it as testng test. Okay, so let click on this start run button. So can you see it is running by itself? Correct. So you can directly run it as testng test. Here is how your details about your class get printed. So this is the print statement that I have provided, correct? And this is the status of execution, so which is your passed demo method, right? So it has passed the method, and number of tests run is 1, failures are 0, skips are 0. So likewise, it is going to generate the test result message on your console. The second thing is you can see here results of running class. So can you see here, even here it is going to provide you a little detail about whatever operations that you have perform. So it is going to show as green if whatever methods you have run is passed. And if you have made it as, if you have run the methods or if the methods have got failed, then it is going to show it in your red mark. All right. So likewise. So now what we are going to do is another important thing that we'll have to understand in your TestNG is your reporting, concept, right? The main intention of using your TestNG in your Selenium along with your Selenium is for reporting purpose. So what is this TestNG going to provide once after you run your test cases? So once after you run your project, okay, not only a class or something, when you run on any classes, when you perform any execution, just refresh your project, okay? As soon as you refresh your project, there's something called as test output folder, which gets automatically added to your Eclipse, that is your project, right? So under your project, you get something called as test output. So here, there are multiple reports that gets generated. And the three important reports that we'll have to understand is your emailable report.html. This particular report is an important report that we are going to share with our stakeholders, right? So just right click. You can directly open with your browser. So it opens in your Eclipse itself. Can you see this beautifully designed report? So it says the method, the class that it is in, and the method that it got executed, and this is start, okay, how it started and the time that it has taken to get executed. And then here are your test results. So default test is one of the test method, and number of tests passed is 1, skipped is 0, and the time it has taken is 208 milliseconds. So likewise, the report gets generated. So this is the report that we are going to share with your stakeholders, right? And the second report that we'll have to understand is your index.html. So this particular report can be shared with your test stakeholders, or you can use it for your internal reference purpose. All right. So now, can you see this? This is the information that you get. Okay. So these are the info. This is nothing but the path of your TestNG report. Number of tests it has. Did you create any groups? No. And the number of times it has run will be shown. And the output, this is nothing but your details. Okay. Just the information. And here are your results. How many methods you have run and how many methods have been passed. So if you want to see the passed methods, click on that show. So it is going to show the methods that has got executed and its status as well. So this is the second report that you'll have to know. The third report is your XML report, which is nothing but your TestNG results.xml. So here it is showing the entire DOM structure of your XML. How this XML file gets generated is based on your project. So here is the project name. It has taken it as default suit, okay? And then you have not created any groups. You have created a test, which is your default test. So this is nothing but your method, right? Your default method, demo method is this one. Okay. It is a default test. The method status is passed. The signature is this one, demo method. Okay. And then you've got the reported output. So this reported output, we're not doing anything with that. So it is not going to show anything. So likewise, these are the three important reports that you're going to use for your reference and also for with your, you share with your stakeholders. Okay. So one is your emailable report.html, and then comes your index.html. And third one is your TestNG results.xml file, right? So this is about your reporting. So next one that we are going to discuss is nothing but the annotations that is provided by your TestNG. So what do you mean by annotations? And what are the different annotations that we have in our TestNG? So these annotations are nothing but a set of rules that has been written already. And using these annotations, it has its specific task to be performed, right? So that is nothing but your annotations. To perform any specific task, it provides a set of rules or it provides a platform to execute the methods based on your requirement. So there are different annotations, 9 important annotations at your class level in order to execute this method. So we are going to understand one by one. So what are the different annotations we have is, the first one, let me create another class. Okay. So here, let me create another class. I say new class. What it is? Annotations demo. Right. I'm going to call it as annotations demo. All right. So the first annotation starts with at the rate before suit. Right? It starts with at the rate before suit. So what does this at the rate before suit do? So this method gets executed before the execution of the rest of the methods or before the execution of your project. So if you want to perform any particular task, for example, say before you run your project, if you want to set up some path or if you want to set up something to be loaded, so then you go with your before suit annotation. So I'm going to just create some dummy methods so to understand the sequence of execution. So I'll say public void before suit method, right? So we'll understand the sequence of how it gets executed. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to print something like this on your console. So this is before, this gets executed before the project starts or before the execution of project starts, right? So the second annotation that we are going to use is the corresponding of your before suit. The once you have used your before suit, there should be something which gets executed after your execution as well, right? So this is what we are going to use, which is your after suit annotation. So this after suit annotation gets executed after the execution of your complete project. For example, say if you want to email a report automatically, even before you without manually sending it, if you want to automate the email sending as well using your TestNG and your Selenium, so you keep all these things at your after suit level. So I say public void after suit method, right? So this is what I'm going to do. Again, I'm going to copy paste this with a little modification, right? So I say it gets executed after the execution of the project, right? After the execution of the project. Okay. So now the next annotation that we'll have to understand is at the rate before test annotation. What does this at the rate before test annotation going to do and when will it get executed? So if you see your testng.xml file, you will have a tag called as test, right? You will have a tag called as test. So likewise, you can create multiple test method, right? So you can create multiple test methods. So if you have to execute something, okay, if you have to execute something after or before your test block in your testng.xml file, right, only then we are going to use your at the rate test annotation. All right, so this before test annotation gets executed before every test tag in your testng.xml file. So let me show you how it gets executed. So this is how you're going to just give, so test name is equal to test. Okay, so before executing this particular test blocks, if you want to execute something, then you're going to keep it here. So I say public void, I say before test method, right? So what does this do? It gets executed before the test block, okay, before the test block in testng.xml file, right? So the corresponding annotation of this is nothing but your at the rate after test. So what does this do? It gets executed after every test block in your testng.xml file. So I say after test method, right? So I say this gets executed after every test block. So this important, this after every test block, it is not, okay? So yeah, after every is very much important because it gets executed after each and every tag of your test tag, okay? So after every test block in your testng.xml file. Then comes your what? At the rate after class, okay? So there's another annotation called at the rate after class. So what does this at the rate after class do? So this at the rate after class gets executed before class first. We'll understand what does this do. Okay. So at the rate before class will get executed before every class in your TestNG, that is your project. So I'll show you how you create a class. So let me take this public void before class method. All right. So now what I'm going to do, let me import this. It was not import, right? So I'm going to say this gets executed before every class in your project, right? So in your project. So In your testng.xml file, once after you have created a test, you're going to create something called as classes. Okay, so within this classes, you're going to create class. So this class tag will tell your testng, so which method or which class to be executed or what methods in which class to be executed. I say class name is equal to, which is the class I've kept here. So it is demo, right? It is your demo a dot Java class, right? So now in your class name here, till now we were using this demo a dot Java in order to execute it, but in your testng file we are going to use your package name dot class name, and there is nothing called as your dot Java extension. So before every class, if you want to execute something, then we are going to add that in your before class annotation, right? So at the same time, another tag, another annotation which helps to execute something after the class is your @ after class annotation, right? So I say public void after class method, correct? So this method gets executed when? This method gets executed after every class in your project, right? Oh, I'm sorry. So let me paste it here and change this after, right? After the, this gets executed before every class, correct? And this is after every class, right? So the next annotation that we have is your @ before method. So what does this @ before method do? This before method gets executed before every test method in your testng file, right? That is nothing but your test class file. So I'll tell you what do you mean by what to say, what we keep in your before method. So I'll give you an example. For example, say if you have to log in, once you log into your Gmail, if you have to log, what to do, you'll have to compose an email. So composing is now a test, that is nothing but your test case. But before you compose an email, what is your prerequisite? Your prerequisite is you would have logged into your application, right? So that is your, that is that means you'll have to log into your Gmail before you send an email, correct? So that particular set of code, which is logging into your Gmail application, will be kept as a prerequisite. That is nothing but your precondition. So such preconditions will be kept inside your before method annotation. So I say public void before method. Okay, so what is this going to do? So this gets executed before every test method in a class, right? So be it a class, be it a project or whatever, before every test method, this block of code is going to get executed, and the corresponding annotation of your before method is your after method. For example, once you have logged into your application, you perform some operation, what is the important thing that you'll have to do? You'll have to log out from that application in order to close it, right? So that is taken care in your @ after method annotation block, right? So I say after method, right? So now what we are going to do is we are going to print something like this. So this gets executed before, sorry, after, I'm sorry, after every test method, right? So this gets executed after every test method. So the last annotation in the hierarchy is your @ test. So this is an important annotation because all your testable scripts are being annotated using your test annotation. So I'm going to say public void, what it is, test method, right? Let me call it as test method. So this is the main script to be executed. So this is how I'm going to execute, right? So if I have to run this program, what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to add the name of this program in your testng.xml file. So that is the standard way of executing any program. So you always use your testng.xml file in order to run it, all right? So what do I do? I'm just going to add it here. So but if I run this, okay, let me run this program and then show you what is going to happen. So let me run this. I'm going to run it as testng sudo, all right? So I have run the program. I'm sorry, there's something. The test tag must define the name attribute. I have not provided the name for it. Okay, here, this is the problem. So let me remove this. I don't want this. We'll create multiple tests later. Okay, we'll show you what actually happened. So let me run. right? So I have run your program. So this is what has got happened. So what we have done, if you see the number of the way of execution of each and every method, you will understand the sequence of annotations execution. So the first one is this gets executed before the execution of your project, which means this is your @before_suit, right? And then comes your @before_test, because it gets executed before every test block in your testng.xml file. Next comes your testng classes, that is your before class annotation. So once after you execute a class, within that class you're going to execute a precondition method. So then comes your @before method annotation. So here is your important task, which is your main script execution. So that will be annotated with what? That will be annotated with your @test. So likewise, it is going to end. So once after the main method is executed, then comes your after method annotation, and then comes your after class, likewise your after test, and then at the end gets executed your after suit annotation. So what is the hierarchy? The hierarchy is the first one is your @before_suit. Next comes your @before_test. Next comes your @before_class. Then comes your @before_method. And then comes your test method. Likewise, it is going to get closed like this. After method, after class, and then comes your after test. And then at the end, it is nothing but your after suit, right? So this is the hierarchy of annotations in your sequence of annotations in your testng, all right? So now the next thing that we have to understand is how do you run multiple classes in your testng? So till now what I've done, I have just run only one class, right? That is your testng.annotations, and the second one is your this is the only class, and the second time we ran your demo A separately. So now how do we execute multiple classes in a single click, right? So that is when you add multiple classes under your classes name. So what it is, I'm going to say testng.demo A, right? If you want to execute multiple classes, then you're going to use this way, all right? So class name is equal to, I have to close. All right. So now if I run this, both your methods get executed. Okay, let me run this. Now you will be able to see. Can you see here? So it says all the methods have got, and then here it says you're working with testng. So now you will be able to distinguish between your annotations, right? Can you see this? Where is it? Here. One, here is your second. So what I told you, your @before class gets executed before every class in your testng, right? So once it has got executed for your testng.annotations class, second time it has got executed for your testng.demo_a class, right? Likewise, your after method as well also gets executed, like, all right? So here is your test method. So this is how your annotations would execute, all right? So the next one is, the next important parameter that you'll have to understand in your testng is the number of times you can execute a particular method, right? How do you execute a method multiple times? So now I'm going to show the same thing, okay? So in your @test method, let me remove this classes. I'll just comment it, okay? All right, so let me comment it like this. Just give me a minute. All right, so I have commented it. This is how you use your comments in your XML file. Okay, so now this is not going to get executed. It is just a comment. So this is what I'm going to execute. So if I want to run this program multiple times, say 10 times, 15 times if I want, then how do I run that test method alone so many times? And before we talk about executing multiple times, executing a method multiple times, we have to know whether we can execute multiple tests method in a single class. So is it possible for us to execute multiple methods in your single class? So for that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create another class. Okay, so I say class. So we will log into your ActiTime itself. So ActiTime. Okay, I'll just name it as ActiTime. So here, I'm going to give you some three important test scripts that you'll have to execute. So what are they? I'm going to create those methods. Public void create user. So this is one of my methods. So I say user created successfully, right? So this is one of my method. Second method is, after I create a user, I want to edit that user. That is, user details I want to edit. So user details has been edited successfully. So this is what I'm going to print once after my operation is done. So the next one is, I want to delete this user. Okay, so public void delete user. All right, so these are the three methods I want to execute. So can I have all these three test methods defined in a single class? User has been deleted. So my answer is yes. So we can have any number of test methods in your single class file. So what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to annotate each and every method with @test annotation, right? So that is all I have to do. So I use here as well @test, and then here again @test, right? So if you see here, so this particular class which I have created has three different test methods, and these three test methods will get executed one over one on a important, what to say, level. So it has its own level of executing this. Your testng is going to execute the test methods in the alphabetical order. For example, say here I have C, here I have E, and then it is D. So the level, the order of execution of your test methods is always in alphabetical, which means C gets executed first, and then D gets executed first, and then E gets executed first. So let me show you. So let me add this class here. I'll remove this demo A. Instead of this demo A, I'll add @time. Okay, this is the name, right? Perfect. So let me run this. Perfect. It is already run. If you see here, it says user created successfully, user has been deleted successfully, and then user details have been edited successfully. So do you think you can perform the same operation using your Selenium in real time? So if you start editing the user, once you have deleted him, what it is going to say? It is going to throw an exception telling that user does not exist, right? So in that case, what we are going to do, we are going to arrange them based on our requirement, right? So how do we set the execution of your test methods is, we are going to assign something called as priority. Okay, so using your priority, we can set the sequence of or the order of execution of your test methods. So this priority is just a parameter provided for your test method. Okay, so test method takes a parameter and then it is going to execute. Okay, priority is equal to 2. Now I'm going to set the priority here as well. Priority is equal to 3. So if you now run your method, it is going to execute in your required format. Can you see here? User created successfully, user details have been edited successfully, and user has been deleted successfully. So this is of course my sequence of or order of execution that I wanted, right? So for that, to execute the methods in the user required format or in the user required sequence, what we use? We use your priority, right? So the priorities should always be in ascending order, which means the least numbered priority will get the first execution, and then it goes in the increasing order, right? So you can use negative priorities as well. Again, you'll have to make sure that whichever is the least will get executed first. So in this case, which is the least number? -3 is your least number mathematically, right? So that is how it gets executed. If you want to see, let me run your program. So can you see here? The least numbered method gets executed first. So make sure that you're going to assign the priority always in the increasing order. It is not that you'll have to provide only the positive integers. You can also provide the negative integers. But keep in mind that your priority parameter will not accept any variable. It will also not accept any kind of decimal values. All right. So if you give this priority is equal to 1.0. Okay, if you provide it like this, 1.0, so it is going to throw an error. So type mismatch cannot convert from double to int, right? So this is not possible. At the same time, if you have any variable, even that is not possible. And you can start the priority from any number, okay? 46, 40, 5, 46, 47, even this is valid. Why? Because it is in your sequential order, right? So if you want to mark this as 12, even then it is going to work. right? So first your 12 gets executed, then your 46, and then your 47. If you want to see, let me run this, right? Can you see it has got executed in your required order, right? So what is priority? Priority is basically used in order to execute your test methods in the user required format. Okay, the priority takes only integers, that is your positive integers as well as your negative integers. You cannot provide any variable, or you can also not provide any decimal values. All right, so this is about your priority. The second thing in your priority is, what if two methods have the same priority? What if two methods have the same priority? In this case, which gets executed first? In this case, again, your test ng is going to choose between these two methods based on your alphabetical order again. So the first, obviously, your create user gets executed, and then comes your delete user again, and then comes your edit user. Why? Because this is in the alphabetical order. So let me run this. So can you see here? Again, user created successfully. This is the first method. Here is your second method, because both your method 2, edit user, and your delete user have the same priority, but they are in different alphabetical format. So it is going to execute it in the alphabetical order. So basically, it is your lexicographical comparison, which means your alphabetical comparison. All right. So the next thing that you'll have to understand is your the different or the number of times you can execute a method. Okay, if you want to execute a method number of times, how do we do? So let me show it here itself. Let me create another test method @test. Okay, here I'm going to create a method called as, let me create a method first. So public void create task. Okay, let me create a task, and now I'm just going to print a statement. So this or user task or task created successfully. So now if I want to run this create task method multiple times, I have to use another parameter for your test method, which is called as invocation count. All right, so invocation count, if you mark it as 5, then it is going to execute this particular method 5 times. By default, the invocation count for all the other test methods will be only once. So if I run this program, okay, let me run it. You can run it directly, or you can run it using your testng.xml file, however you want, okay? If you run this program, so here it is. So task created successfully. Right, and then comes your user created successfully. User has been modified. Why this has happened? Because I told you it is going to perform a lexicographical comparison, which means here also it is create, right? Here also it is create, here also it is create. But the next character, the task T, comes first and then comes your U, right? So that is nothing but your lexicographical comparison. If you want to again use this or execute this method after your priority 3 of your delete user, then what you can do is you can give that priority as well here. Just separate it by, separate the different parameters by a comma. All right, so I say priority is equal to 4. So this gets executed at the end. All right, so here it has got executed. Can you see here? This is how you execute. All right, so now, so this is about your executing a method multiple times, executing multiple test methods in a class, providing the priorities to execute them on the required sequence, and then comes your executing multiple classes in a single file. And we have also understood your annotations, right? So let me go back to your slide. We'll check what we have covered till now. Okay, we have discussed what is your test ng. Here, test ng, types of advantages of test ng. Yes, we have discussed. Your annotations are provided, and then you have your reports. You can perform parallel testing. So, what do you mean by parallel testing? Parallel testing is nothing but executing the same test case on multiple browsers. If you have come across a word called as compatibility testing or your cross-browser testing, that is also possible using your test ng. All right. And annotations, of course, will make your life easy, and you can group them and you can prioritize them. So this is your advantages of TestNG. So we have seen how to install your TestNG plugin, right? And then So we have seen how to create a project and how to convert it into a TestNG class. And then we have seen how to write TestNG classes, right? So the benefits, of course, we have discussed your annotations. And what we have discussed is we have discussed about your reports till now. And we also discussed about your sequencing. And then comes your benefits. So in that benefits, the first one which we have dealt is your annotations. So there are different annotations here. Annotations are lines of code that are inserted in the program to control the execution. So these are used to configure your test cases, right? So these are the annotations that we have seen till now, with the 9 annotations which we have seen till now. So the next one that we are going to see is your data provider, your listeners, your parameters, and your factory. So all these things we'll be seeing in the later stages. And then, so here is an example for you to set up your TestNG class. You can go through the steps, okay, later on, and you can start executing them. Okay, we have discussed on what this also does, right, on your console, what gets printed. And when you refresh, there is something called as your TestNG output. So in that, what are the different ports that we have to look into? And then the property of TestNG is that it is mainly used to execute the XML files, which helps us to run our test parallelly. So we'll understand this, okay? So here you're going to create a folder. So configuration, so this gets configured automatically once you convert your project into TestNG. So you don't have to go ahead and create a testng.xml file. It is now overruled. Okay, we don't want to do this. If you want, you can still create it. Okay, it is not a big deal. Just right click, select a file, and you can start creating your own testng.xml file. Okay, so there are different ways, right? There are different ways. And this is the hierarchy of your suits, tests, and classes, the structure of your testng.xml file, which we have already seen, right? So here is an example of executing multiple classes in a single testng.xml file, right? So all the classes details will be provided here, the execution results. Now comes your grouping. So what do you mean by grouping? So let's not create a dummy group. So, but instead, we are going to talk something about the real time that happened, all right? So you guys know what are the different types of testing that we are going to perform in using your Selenium. So we can perform functional testing, we can perform regression testing, and along with which there's something called as smoke testing test cases that we execute, right? So once a build has come, the first thing that anybody would perform is what? We smoke test the build, right? So for that, think that we have fetched if I have some 15 modules, right? We are going to fetch the critical features, the critical functionality test cases, and we are going to perform the basic and critical operations on your build to check whether the build is testable or not. In that case, what we are going to do is we are going to create something called as groups, and using these groups, we are going to execute the test cases. So now let me show you how we create your groups and how to execute that particular group. All right, so let me copy this, let me create another class. So let me not club everything in a single one. So I'm going to say group demo. All right, so here I'm going to copy the same thing from here, but I'm not going to give any priorities. Okay, but instead I'm going to remove all this. Okay, so let me copy this, put it everywhere. That's better. All right. Perfect. So we have 4 different test methods. The first one is your group creation. Okay, all right. So let me do another thing. I say @test. Okay. And I'm going to create something called as public void create. What should I take? Create timesheet. Okay. So create timesheet is a method that I'm going to create now. So I'm going to say log time. Okay. So I'll say log time. So here what I'm going to do, I'm going to perform an operation of logging timesheet is completed. All the timesheet has been logged complete successfully. So whatever you want, you can print, right? So here, what are the important tasks that I have to do is I'll have to start fetching or identifying the basic scenarios from each and every modules, right? So what is the basic functionality in the user module? It is your create user. So once after the create user gets executed, only then we can edit the user. right? In that case, I'm going to consider this to be the basic and the critical functionality, and I will be providing a parameter called group for this test method, and I'm going to call this under your smoke test case, right? So this is what I'm going to fetch in your, did I provide it properly? Groups is equal to perfect, right? This is how we provide. So again, in the same way, we are going to talk about the next module, which is your create task, right? In your task module, we are supposed to provide what? We are supposed to perform our operation, or your smoke functionality should be checked in your creating tasks as well. So before we perform any other operations, we should be able to create the task, right? So that is what we are going to perform here. And the next one is from your timesheets. So in this also, we are going to take this log time to be the critical functionality, right? So once after I'm done, so how do I run this? So in order to run this, it is mandatory that you will have to run your testng.xml file with a tag called as group. So this particular group should be created under your test tag. So here I go ahead and create something called as groups. Under your groups, you have to provide a tag called run, okay? So this run tag will execute whatever classes you have provided or whatever groups name you have provided under this. So now if you run only, so there are two things that you can add in your run. One is include. So once you include the group name, then it is going to execute only that particular, it is going to execute that particular group. If you exclude something, then it is going to exclude that particular group and it is going to run rest of them. All right, we'll see how to run test cases using exclude as well. So now when I run this particular test suite, it is going to execute only your smoke test cases. All right, so it says it has run successfully. Total test run is zeros. Just give me a minute. So did I include any name? So what is the name that I've given for this? Is it smoke? Yes, this is smoke. All right. Okay. All right. The class name is different, right? So I have to give this groups demo. This is the problem. So what it is, it says groups demo, correct? So this is the class that I'll have to run. Okay. Control C. Here I'll have to do it because that is a comment, right? So now let me run this. So if I now run this, it is going to execute only the smoke test cases. Can you see here? Logging timesheet is completed. Task created successfully. User created successfully. Do not worry about the execution. So whatever level of execution or sequence of execution it does, it is fine with us. So all we want is the basic and the critical functionality should be tested and it should pass, right? So it has passed successfully. So this is how we create groups and we are going to work with them. So now if I have multiple groups created, think I'm going to add this test method under groups called groups is equal to, what do I say? I call this as regression. Okay, I call this as regression. And here I'm going to add the rest of them to 1-2 regression. All right, so here I'm going to use this. And the second one I'm going to use is, okay, let me create two more test methods. @test. Okay, so public void edit task. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Edit task. All right. So here what I'm going to do, I'm going to just print something like this. Task edited successfully. Right. So likewise, I'm going to create another method called as delete task. All right. So I say deleted successfully. Here I'm going to add the group name as groups is equal to. So what do I say? I just say something like this. Okay. I can give two different, I can mark it under two different groups. Okay. If you want to just perform smoke test cases on only your create module, or if you want to perform smoke test cases under only your regression test cases on only your task module, so even that is possible. So I'm going to show you how. So now I'm going to group this under tasks, okay, and then I'm going to group this under what? Regression. Okay, likewise you can perform again. Even this is tasks and regression. So let me copy the entire thing. Okay, so now here I'm going to mark this as regression along with your, what it is, users. right? So I can take it like this, users, comma, regression. So likewise here as well, users, comma, regression. Now what I want to perform is I want to execute this users and perform this regression test. In that case, what I'm going to do, I've already told this include name is equal to regression, and I'm going to say include name is equal to what it is. It is user, right? So check for the proper name. Perfect. It is users. And now I'm going to exclude something. What am I going to exclude? Since I've already performed the smoke testing, it is not important for me, or I don't want to execute your smoke test cases again. So what I say, I exclude your smoke test cases, right? If you now run your code, okay, now what it is going to do, it is going to perform, or it is going to execute all your regression test cases. So can you see here, task deleted successfully, user has been deleted successfully, task edited, and user has been edited successfully. It has executed all your regression cases because you have included your regression. And then if you want to, and it is not considered, or it has excluded your what? It has excluded your smoke test cases. So likewise you can perform anything. So if you want to exclude, okay, apart from your smoke, if you want to exclude your regression for what? Regression for your tasks. In that case, you say, sorry, this is your users. Now I want to exclude regression for task as well, which means I have to perform regression for only what? Your user module. In that case, I'm going to remove this. Is this the name that I've given? Task. Yeah, this is the one. And I'm going to close this. Now, if you execute this testng.xml file, the regression would have got performed only on your user module, right? So this is how it works. Can you see? This is the usage of your groups. All right, so what do? We group the test cases into different groups, like your regression, your functional, your smoke, your customers, your tasks, depending on whatever modules you have and what are the types of testing that you have to perform. So once after that is done, in your testng.xml file, under your groups tag, you use a run tag, and within that, you can use your include tag and exclude tag in order to execute or in order to restrain from executing the particular groups. All right, so this is nothing but your grouping. So we'll see what we have discussed. So in your grouping, we have seen, so when do you want to define the test method separately in different class? When do we want to execute some test methods present in the code? So you go with grouping, right? It again depends on what needs to be executed and what has to be excluded from execution, right? So here, this is how you create groups. This groups is just a demo, but I've shown it in the real time way. All right, so you understand how to run this. Under your test, there you create something called as group. Under your run, you include or exclude, right? So based on including, based on the different classes as well, you can perform. So that is what is shown here. All right, so the next one is nothing but your sequencing. In your sequencing, we have already seen one way of sequencing it. What it is nothing but your priorities, right? The second way of doing is your dependency. So what do you mean by dependency? I'll tell you what is meant by dependency. So if one test case is depending on another test case, right? So if one test case is depending on another test case, then we are going to create some dependency, and we will make this method to wait until independent method or the dependent method gets executed properly. All right, so that is what we do here. Prioritization, it's already seen. Okay, so now we are going to see something called as depends on. So what do? With depends on, we are just going to say depends on method, and we are going to provide. So let me show you that as well. Okay, so for example, we were discussing about your acti time. So in your acti time, we were providing something called as priorities, right? So the first, same thing, let me define the depends on methods as well and show how it works, right? So I'm going to create another class telling that depends on demo, right? So what do? I'm going to provide it like this. Let me remove this edit user. I'm going to remove this as well. Also your priority on your delete user. So now what actually we are going to do is we are going to set the depends on parameter for this test method. All right. So in order to perform the or execute the method delete user, what you have to do, your edit user or your create user should be executed, right? So in order to edit, what needs to be done, the user must have got created before, right? So for this edit user, I'm going to add this depends on. So I have depends on method, right? So here I'm going to give depends on method is equal to what? Which is the method name that we have? The method name that we have is your create user. Right. So if you provide this method name, then you're going to execute that particular method after your create user method has been executed. Right. So likewise, you can provide the same for your delete user as well. So let me show you that. Depends on method is equal to what it is. It is your edit user. Correct. So without editing the user, you're not going to delete. So according to our sequence, right? So that is what we are going to do. So now again, in your testng.xml file, if you want, you can edit it, or let me run it here and show you. All right. So if you see here, first your user gets created, then your user details get edited, and then comes your deleted method, right? So very much similar. So like we were providing priority, but here we are going to create dependency on each and every method so that before that method gets executed, or before that operation has been performed, or until and unless that method gets successfully passed, then the next method will not get executed. So when do we use this is, for example, say in your real time, you're testing some application and this particular method, one such method gets failed. For example, say create user gets failed. So just think, without the user getting created, we will not be able to perform some operation on the user, right? So without creating it, it doesn't make sense if you try to edit that user, if you try to delete that user. In that case, what we are going to do is, if this test case is going to fail, we are going to skip these test cases in order to save the execution time and in order to ensure that this methods will also not throw any exceptions, right? So that is when we are going to add this depends on method in order to create dependency at even for the level of execution. At the same time, it is to save the execution time as well and proper documentation as well, right? And the second depends on can be used along with your groups as well. So if I go to this groups demo, right? If I go to this groups demo, until and unless the user gets created, right? Until and unless the user gets created, he will not be able to log this particular timesheet, right? He will not be able to log his timesheet. So now what you can do is, if you name this as timesheet, okay, this group is timesheet. Okay, let me create another class. Let me not confuse you guys here. So I'm going to copy one method, your group method, create user method. So here I would say create class depends on groups demo. All right. So the first one that I'm going to use here is your users, okay, group name is equal to users, and the next one is your tasks, right? So that is the only two methods that I'm going to take. So where is it? Here, this one, right? So here what I'm going to do, I'm going to name this as tasks. Okay, so now along with your groups, what we are going to do is we are going to mark it as depends on your particular group, right? So let me show you how we do it. So here you're going to say depends on method. So once that gets executed, you're going to mark it as depends on group as well. So this particular method. So here you say depends on, can you see this, groups, right? So what is the group name? The group name is nothing but your user, right? So here I'm going to use this. I'm going to say what? I'm going to say users. So now, if you perform this operation, until and unless this user gets executed, this is not going to get executed, right? So let me run this and show. Actually, we are going to use your testng.xml file. So can you see here what has happened? So since we have also created a group here, so all your groups would get executed. And once after the user has got created successfully, only then your logging timesheet would be allowed. So likewise, it is going to execute. Got it? So this is how the entire groups gets into picture. All right. So now the next one that we are going to talk about is your... Once after your grouping is done, let me take the next one, dependencies. Okay, prioritization is done, dependencies is done, right? So the next one is how to enable or disable a test case. So if you don't want to execute a test case, how do you refrain them from execution? So let me not show it here. So again, I'm going to take another one, depends on demo here. Okay, so let me copy this method. Okay, so what we are going to do, enabling or disabling, right? So that is what we are going to say. So enable, disable, demo. All right, so what we are going to do, we are going to enable few methods and we are going to disable few methods and then we are going to execute them. So how do you enable them? How do you disable them? You have a special, what to say, keyword or parameter in your testng called as enabled. So just by setting it to true or false, you can enable that method. So you say enabled is equal to true. Okay, if you set it as true, then it is going to execute. And if you set it as false, enabled is equal to false, then it is not going to execute that particular test case. So let me show you that enabled is equal to true. So what am I going to do? This is taking your Boolean value, right? You can either provide a value called true or false and nothing else. So if I now run this program, only these two methods gets executed and your delete user would not get executed, right? So let me show you that as well. So can you see here? So passed user, create user and edit user. So test run is only two. Why? Because your other method is restricted from getting executed. So this is how you enable and disable your test case, right? So this is the next concept. So you have a lot of things like that. So along with which, the important thing that you will have to learn about is your parameterization in your testng. So what do you mean by parameterization? Till now, what we have seen is we have just provided a method, we have just created a method, and what we were doing, we were just looking into it. Now we'll start discussing about the real time test cases. Okay, so let us start logging into the application and we are going to fetch, instead of hard coding the value, we are going to fetch the value from the external way. Okay, so not from your Excel sheets or something. So we are going to pass the values from your XML sheets, or you can also pass the value from a different program. So we are going to see how to do it. So there are two annotations that we have to discuss importantly. One is your @ parameter annotation and the second one is your @ data provider annotation. So how do we work with these two? So the first one will help you to take the parameters from another class, and the second one will help you to take the parameters from an external file called your XML sheet. Okay, so we'll start working with, right? So one is from your testng XML, the second one is from your data provider. So we'll see first how your parameterization works from your XML sheet, right? So just we'll go to this. All right, so let me write a program first. So let me write a program wherein I log into the application, right? A new class, and I say login to app, right? So I'm going to make this as what? @ test method. I'm going to annotate it with @ test method. So I say public void login. Correct. So here I'm going to pass the username and password as parameters, wherein we'll be driving the values from the external file. Okay. So uname and pass. So what am I supposed to do? First, I'm going to use something called as @ before method, wherein I'm going to set all your prerequisites here. So what is it? Public void. What it is? It is nothing but your, I'll name it as preconditions itself, preconditions. What am I supposed to do here? I'm supposed to set the system property. I'm supposed to launch the browser. I'm supposed to navigate through the URL first. So if I already have a program like that, let me pick it up. All right, basic. Do we have something? Log into Gmail, locators. We don't have anything like that. All right, so this is not the one. Oh, perfect. We already have it. So these two statements, I'm going to pick it. Okay. So what am I doing? I'm just setting the system properties. I'm launching the browser. And what I'm doing? I'm just navigating through the URL. So let me make it a global variable, public web driver. Driver is equal to none. Okay, the industry standard way of doing it. So let us follow the same as well. Driver is equal to new Chrome driver, driver.get, HTTPS, and this is the URL. So once after I have found the URL, what is the next thing that I'm going to do? I'm going to locate that element. So how do I locate that element? I have to inspect it. Okay, so let me inspect it here. So I'm inspecting it here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to find this element, right? So here, yes, let me inspect. Move your cursor on your username. So it has its own ID known as username, correct? So I'll copy that. What I'm going to do, I'm going to write the script here. So driver.findElementById, and I'm going to pass this ID. So once after I identify this element, what I'm going to do? I'm going to send the keys, right? So what keys I'm going to send? The username. So here, the username, I'm not going to hard code. Instead, I'm going to fetch it from an external file. So this particular value will be passed here, right? So the next one is what? The next one is your password. So I say driver.findElementById.name. So the name here is PWD. So let us cross check. Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to inspect this element. The name here is PWD, perfect. So what we are going to do, we are going to send keys again. What is the keys that we are going to pass? We are going to pass this pass, right? So which we are again driving it from the external file. So the next operation that we are going to do is driver.findElementById. What it is, I'm going to write my XPath, okay, and I'm going to pass this, and I'm going to click on this login button, right? So this I'm going to inspect again. So here it is. So it is a div. So let me write my own XPath. Right. So how do I write? /div. So it is the text. Text is equal to, in single quotes, I'm going to pass the value and then I'm going to close this braces. So this is what I've done. So now I have already, you know, set the class. My class is done. My test method is ready. But where do I keep my parameters? So your parameters can be kept in your testng.xml file. So I'll have to modulate your testng.xml first. So let me comment this entire thing. Okay. So what am I going to do is, I'm going to use something called as parameter. So the parameter name is what? The parameter name is your username. And the value is what? The value is selenium788. So this is the value. So whatever parameter you provide here will be passed to this particular, the value will be passed to this particular uname. All right. So, and again, the second one is what? The second one is your password. So I use this parameter name is equal to password. And the value is what? The value is nothing but your Apple 12345. So here, let me mark it as uname because my parameter there is uname. Right, so let me give it here, and this is not enough. Okay, so what is the class name that I'm executing? Login to app. Let me mark it here. So login to app, right? So this is not enough. So for your test method, since you're passing your parameters, all you have to do is use this @parameters, okay, @parameter from your testng annotation. And this parameters will take two arguments. One is what? One is your uname. The second one is your path. So these are the two values that you're going to pass. So let me add it like this. So this is one. This is the second one, right? So we are passing your two parameters. Just give me a minute. Syntax error, token expected. All right. So the first one is your U name. The second one is your pass. So this will be like this, but within this I have to give your flower braces. So if you forget this, it will not, right? So this is how we provide your parameters from your XML sheet. So let us cross check with this is what we have done. So what we are doing, we are going to, okay, they are showing you the other application. So all right, this we have already done. All right, see here. So under your test, you're going to provide your parameter name, which is your name that you're going to pass and the value that you're going to pass. And then you're going to call that particular class. And then in your file, you're going to pass this parameters. Whatever name that you have given there will be provided here. Okay, all these two. And then you're going to execute your code. So let me execute my code likewise. So what I'm supposed to do, I'm supposed to run your testng.xml file. So let me check, because there are a lot of comments. If we miss something, it is not going to work. So now it's perfect. Let me run this, right? So @before method, as I told you, will get executed before your test method, which means all your launching of your browser, navigating of your URL will be taken by that @ method. So after that, now it is going to fetch the value from your XML file and it is going to start work, right? Can you see here? It has fetched the value from your XML file and it has logged into the application, right? So this is nothing but your parameterization using your @parameters annotation. The second way of doing it, okay, the second way here, you can see your results as well. The second way of doing is using your @dataProvider annotation, wherein instead of your testng.xml file, you're going to derive the value from an external class. Okay, so we are going to see how to do that. So here I'm going to create a class. Okay, so where is it? It is here. So create class. So I'm going to say class, data provider class. Okay, then here what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a method which stores all the data. So how do I say? I just say public object. Okay, object. I'll tell you what is this object and why I'm using this object. I say get data. All right. So one important thing that you will have to understand is your @dataProvider method will always return a object type, and that is your two-dimensional array. So any object can be returned. Either you can directly return your object, which is the supermost class of all the classes in your Java, or you can also return any object of type string, because if you're sending or if you're returning string values, then return your string values, or if you want to create irrespective of any object for that matter, you can use the supermost class. So in this, what we are going to do is we are going to create a two-dimensional array. For example, say I say credentials, okay, credentials is equal to, first what I'm going to do, I'm going to create a two-dimensional array here. Oh, I'm sorry, it is not your string, right? It is your object. So object. So here I'm going to take only one set of username and password. So I say 1, 2. So which means, so this two-dimensional array will act like your matrix, right? So like your table. So you have rows and columns. So this is one row, this is two columns. Why two columns? One column is for your username. The second column is for your password, right? So how do you assign value to your two-dimensional array? You say credentials of, you use your offset value. What is your offset value? The index value of your first row and the first column, which would always starts from your zero. So here you say 0, 0, right? So 0, 0. So let me close this. So is equal to, what is the username? Your username is selenium7880. So my first set of username is ready. The second thing that I'm going to store is your password. So this is nothing but the first row and the second column, which is 1 of 1, which is equal to your Apple 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is your password. So this is nothing but your setting up of your data provider class. Now what you have to do, you have to return the credentials you have created, right? You have to return the credentials you have created. Now I'm going to create another class called login. Okay, so here I say login to @time. Okay, what I'm going to do, I'm going to use the same approach, okay, but the difference will be from the place that you're going to drive the input, right? So let me copy this login to app, okay? I'm going to perform the same thing like your at the rate before method, after method, everything would be the same. But instead of your parameters, we are going to use something else, okay? So I'm going to remove this parameters. So we'll understand what this class is doing. So now what am I doing? I'm just going to say at the rate before method. So in your before method, what I'm going to do, I'm just launching this browser, navigating through the URL. And what I'm doing, I'm logging into the application using your username and password, correct? So for this test method, what you're going to do is, you're going to call something called as, so here I say data provider is equal to what it is. It is your get data method, correct? It is your get data method. And where is this get data coming from? This get data is coming from your which method is that? Data provider class. So for that, what you're supposed to do is, for this you have to take something called as data provider class. You have something called as data provider class. So this class will take this argument, which is your, just okay, I'll have to rename this, just give me a minute. So we already have something called as data provider, okay? Data provider, this is also okay. So data set, this is what I'm going to rename it as. So let me rename the compilation unit as well. So here what I'm going to do is, data provider class is equal to data set, sorry. So this is nothing but your data set dot class. All right. So this is what we are going to pass. It says what? Okay. Do I have a method? I don't have a method here, right? So data provider class, variable declarator ID expected after this token. Data provider class, or I'm sorry. This has to be like this. It is your data set. So this is your data provider class. Okay, so you can either do like this, or there's some confusion here. So instead of this, we are going to take it like this. So data provider is equal to get data. So here what we are going to do, we can add it here itself, right? So data provider, yes, provider class is equal to, yes, this is the one. Okay, why am I creating it? Let me not do this here itself. So I'm going to use this data provider class in your data set itself. Okay, so let me use it there. I can directly give it. All right, so this should work, but I'll have to provide the class name. All right, not a problem. So let me use this data set here. Okay, so this is from a different place. This is what I'm going to cut. Let me add this here, right? So this web driver driver is equal to null. I'll make it here. So what am I going to do? I'm going to use this particular class. Okay, so it is not providing you me the data provider class, so that is the problem. So now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to keep this particular data set separately, and then I'm going to use your before method to launch your browser, navigate to the URL. At the same time, we are going to use this data provider annotations, okay, and you can start working with your fetching of your data and log into your application. So let me run this program. Okay, launch and start. So it will now, okay, there's some error. Just give me array index out of bounds exception. Okay, the problem here is, okay, all right. So get data. So I have one, username and one password. Correct data provider method. Perfect. So data provider is equal to get data, username, password. It is one row, two columns, 0, 0, and all right. This is the problem. It is 0, 1, which is your first row and first column. I'm sorry for that. So you have to be very careful when you're providing your, the row number. All right, that is the reason we were getting. So now it is going to launch your browser, navigate through your URL. right? So it is launching the browser. It is going to navigate through your URL. It is entering the username and password, and it is logging into your application with the data set we have provided. So this is how you're going to work with your data provider annotation in order to fetch this particular value, all right? So now we are going to cross check with the slide, okay, whether we have covered this or not. So what we have done, now we are going to understand this data provider annotation. So this is how you provide @ test data provider is equal to input data, and the data provider is here. So once you are done, this is how you fetch it, and this is how it gets executed, right? So the next thing that we have to understand is nothing but your parallel testing. What do you mean by parallel testing? Parallel testing is also known as your compatibility testing, or you can also call it as your cross-browser testing. So which means you're going to test your application on multiple browsers, right? So for example, if you want to run your code on your Google Chrome as well as on your Firefox as well, on your Internet Explorer as well, you're going to perform all this execution in a single class, right? Just by using your parallel testing technique, you're going to execute your code on your different browsers, and also on different machines can also be performed. So let us see how to perform your parallel testing. So as we have already, as we already know, what do you mean by parallel testing? So we are going to run our scripts in two different browsers. So how do we run it? So let me create a new package. So what do I say? I call it as parallel testing. All right. So parallel testing, or I can call it as parallel execution as well. Let me call it as parallel execution. So here what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a class, new class. So in this class, I'm going to log into your ActiTime application. All right. So again, here I'm going to have two different methods. One is annotated with your before method annotation. And this is going to be what? This is going to be the precondition method, right? So usually how we write it, so this precondition method, what we are going to write. So the browser settings we are going to do, and we are going to launch the browser, navigate through the URL. So all these things would be present. So let me copy that three lines. Okay, so not this one. Log into app. Right here, these are the three methods that we have. So along with which, I'm going to show you how we are going to modify this. Here, public web driver. Driver is equal to what? Null for the first time. Right, let me import this driver from Selenium. Now, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to maximize the window. So what I say, I just say driver. Right, I say driver dot manage dot windows dot maximize. So this is how we are going to maximize the window, along with which we are going to use some weights as well. So the standard way of doing is what I'm going to set. So what I say driver dot manage dot timeouts this time, right? So timeouts dot implicitly wait, I'm going to provide 10 seconds. Okay, so I use this time unit dot second. So this is for your Chrome driver. So we have already used this for Chrome driver. So now what are we going to do is we are going to parameterize the value based on your test method. Okay, so we are going to get into something called as two different test methods in your testng.xml file, and we are going to execute it. So how do we execute it? The same method we are going to modify a little. There's something called as XML test. Okay, there's something called as XML test. So this class will be helpful for you to fetch the value from your parameter level. Okay, so for the first thing, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take something called as a variable called as browser. So using this, I'm going to get the browser. Okay, sorry, I'm going to get this parameter, and I'm going to name it as I'm going to give the parameter name as browser itself. Okay, so this is going to be my browser, right? So this browser, I'm going to add it in your testng.xml file. Okay, so once I'm done with this, so let me go to your testng file now. Here There are a lot of things. Let me clear everything, okay? Because it is a bit confusing when we create multiple things. So let me remove this as well for now, okay? So what I'm going to do, so this is what we have kept, right? Just the class name. So what is the class name? It is your parallel execution dot parallel execution dot login to ActiTime is the class, correct? Login to ActiTime. So this T is capital, right? So this is what we are going to do. Now, this is for your one browser. So for that, what you're supposed to do is you're going to pass this parameter. The parameter name is browser and the value will be Chrome. All right. So the value will be Chrome. The same set of tests is going to be repeated in your suit level. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to create another test. Here I say Chrome test. Okay. Here I'm going to say Firefox test. Okay. So Firefox test and the browser name here is Firefox. Okay. This is what I'm supposed to do. So what I'm doing here, I'm creating two different test suite. One to be performed using your, using your Firefox, and one is using your Google, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get parameter of this browser. All right. So this browser, and I'm going to use it here. So here I'll name it as browser one. Okay. So we'll resolve this. Don't worry. It says create local variable. We'll resolve it. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to print this browser value. Okay. So what is the browser value that I'm going to print? The browser that you have selected is what? Browser one. Right. So that is what we are going to do. So the next one is I'm going to check if this browser one that we have chosen equal ignore case. Okay. We are going to ignore the cases. Okay. Equal ignore case. And if it is Chrome. Okay. If it is Chrome, then perform this operation. What it is, we are going to launch only your Google Chrome. Correct. So this is what we are going to do. Now, if it is not your Google Chrome, then what we are going to do? We are going to launch your Mozilla Firefox. How do we launch your Mozilla Firefox? I am going to again set the system property. I say, so first, one important thing that you'll have to know about your Mozilla Firefox is you have to download a driver called as Geeko Driver, okay, from your seleniumhq.org. So here you have this seleniumhq.org. So before that, even before you download your driver, so you would have downloaded your Google Chrome. So this Google Chrome, so we'll have to check the property of this Google Chrome first. So let me launch this Google Chrome. Okay, so then we'll have to find for this particular, its configuration, right? So I go here to the menu and here you have something called as help, right? So go to this help. You have to click on this about Firefox. So once you go to this about Firefox, you would be checking what is the configuration of your Firefox. So you'll have to ensure one thing. The first thing that you're going to do is you are going to download your Firefox version 56 itself. Okay. And the Selenium standalone server should be your 3.8 onwards. If in case you have to work with your Geeko driver and only then your Firefox would be launched using your Selenium. Okay, so there's a lot of bugs that have been raised with respect to your Firefox and your Selenium. So use your Selenium standalone server 3.8 version. Along with that, use your Firefox 56 and not your 57 and whatever version is the newest. Do not use it. Use always 56 or below, between your 54 and 56, and ensure you're going to download Geeko driver based on this bit configuration. So here you go to your seleniumhq.org, go to download, and once you go to download, you will find this third-party browsers and drivers, right? You go here and you do what? You're going to click on this 0.19. All right. So click on that 0.19. Do not click on the browser name. You have to click on that 0.19. Once you click on that, you have your assets here. All right. So go ahead and download whatever configuration you want based on your operating system. If it is Mac, use this Mac OS. If it is Windows, go with this 32 or 64. So let me download this 32-bit. Okay. So it should get downloaded now. So let me download it first. So now it has got downloaded. Once it gets downloaded, all you have to do is go here. Okay. So just unzip this. Okay. So you right click on it, unzip this to any folder. So once you have unzipped, you get this Geeko driver, right? You get this folder, Geeko driver. Copy this geekodriver.exe file and go to this particular folder, right? So here you would have kept your drivers, right? Here you'll have to paste your geekodriver.exe. So once you paste this here, copy the path of this, right click, properties, the same thing that you perform for your Chrome driver. So the same thing you'll perform it here as well with a little modification. Okay, so before you launch this, okay, with parentheses, I mean with your double quotes. Now what we are going to do is we are going to start with your setting of your capabilities. There's something called as desired capabilities. Okay, so here I create this desired capabilities for your Firefox. You say desired capabilities dot Firefox, right? So once you set this capabilities, you will have to set a capability property. So set capability, okay, and then you're going to provide the capability value. Yes, this is the one. So which is your marionette. So this is an important capability of your Firefox. So it accepts your marionette and the boolean value is true. So once you're done with this, you're going to set your system property. So which says set dot system property. Here, what is your system property? Your system property is webdriver.geeko.driver. So you're not going to say mozillafirefox.driver. Instead, you say geeko.driver. And the value that you're going to pass is the path of this executable file, right? So let me copy this. So you're going to paste it here, right? So once you have pasted, what you're going to do? You're going to launch the browser. So I say driver is equal to new Firefox browser, right? That is nothing but your Firefox driver. So what have we done? All we have done is we have set your precondition. What we have done here, the first thing we have done is we have launched your, we have taken the parameter from your XML sheet, wherein the parameter will be your browser. So using this browser, we are going to print what is the browser that you have selected. Either it is Chrome or it is your Firefox. So you can use another condition here. Else if what it is browser dot equals ignore case. So sorry, this is browser one, right? So browser one dot equals ignore case. Okay. If it is Firefox. Right, if it is Firefox, then go ahead and perform this, right? Else you can also throw a message after this. You can throw a message else. So what we are going to do, we are going to say invalid browser name. So please check and provide valid browser to be launched. So likewise, you can provide some information. All right, so let me keep this inside a block just to distinguish. Okay, so now what we have done, we are checking for the parameter from your testng.xml file, right? So using this testng.xml file, we are going to pass the browser, and then based on that browser value, we are going to check which browser you're going to take. So if it is the Chrome browser, you're going to launch the Chrome browser and then you're going to execute. If it is Firefox browser, you're going to launch the Firefox browser and then you're going to execute. So the next one is your method that has to be tested. So here I'm going to use your @test method. So what we are going to do is we are going to create this login method. Okay. So what do? I copy paste, right? So because we have already logged in. So let me use this. So driver.find element of whatever. And I'm going to pass the values. So what is the keys that I'm going to pass? The keys is selenium7080. And the password that I'm going to pass is apple. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? So this is how we are going to provide the value. And here, so when you have the parallel testing, it is important for you to have your testng.xml file. So if you run it directly, then it is not going to execute the way you want. Okay, can you see here? It says configuration failures, null pointer exception. So it is not going to work. So always make use of your testng.xml file. So let me run this. So testng suite. So I'm running this program. So now the browser you have selected is Chrome. So it is now going to launch your Google Chrome. Okay, so it is launch the Google Chrome. It is navigating to the URL. Now it will enter your username, enter your password, and then it is going to work. So this has worked, right? So the second thing is you have selected another browser. Can you see here? The browser that you have selected is Firefox. Now it is going to start launching your Firefox browser. Okay. So yes, it is launching your Firefox browser. So it has launched. All right, there's something called as configuration failures. So let me check what actually happened. So let me close this. I think that is better. That I told you, right? There is always a problem with your Mozilla Firefox, right? So it says configuration failure. The failure exception is nothing. So only problem is with your configuration. So Marionette, debug, register, listener. All right, let me try this. Where is it? Active time. Desire. Yes. Driver is equal to Firefox driver of your cap. So this capabilities I'm going to send. Now let me run this and see what is going to do. So run as your testng suite, right? So yes, your Google Chrome would work. That is by default, it is going to work. So here it is. It is launching your browser. It is going to navigate through your URL. It is going to maximize the window. And then it enters the username, it enters the password, and then it would be done, right? So now it is launching your Mozilla Firefox. It has to enter your username, log into your application, or it has to throw an exception. We'll see what is the problem with this. It is already thrown the exception. So Geeko driver, Marionette info enabled, Chromium source. Have I provided the path properly? Yes. Alright, so let me verify why this problem has come up. Here is login time. Okay, wait. So Firefox test, right? Browser is equal to Firefox. Alright, so this is done. Let me check what is the problem. So you will encounter a lot of problem when you're working with your Firefox browser, because it is the problem is once after they converted it into your Selenium WebDriver 3 was converted, then the problem is with your Geeko drivers. The Geeko driver will not allow you properly to work with it. So let me check the part of it, whether I have provided correctly or not. Yes, Geeko driver.exe capability, desired capability. Okay, desired capabilities dot yes. Okay, capabilities dot Firefox. I've set the capability of Marionette. I've set the system path and I have launched your Firefox driver. All right, so let me. Okay, this seems to be correct, but why is it not working? So desired capabilities cap is equal to Firefox capability dot set capability Marionette Geeko driver. So this also I had removed, right? So else, yes, this is what you're going to do. And in your testng.xml file, parameter name is equal to browser, perfect, value is equal to Firefox. Am I checking for Firefox itself? Yes, equal ignore case Firefox itself. So in that Firefox, what am I going to do? I'm going to execute this parallel execution login to ActiveTime. So here, let me run this again and check. All right. So though your code is right, though you have set everything properly, your Firefox always has problems. We don't have to worry about it. So let me see now once it launches your Firefox. Now it is launching your Firefox, right? Yeah. So it has to log in. It has to navigate through the URL, which it is not doing. But instead, it might have thrown an exception or an error. All right. So let me check. Geeko driver is listening. So my Geeko driver is 32-bit, right? Or 64-bit that I downloaded. So 32-bit, Win32-bit. Let me check again. So where is your Geeko driver? Here it is. Geeko driver 32-bit. Perfect. So this is the one which I downloaded. Okay. enabled Marionette component return failure code. So my add-on manager startup reads startup data, stack race, load extension state. All right, so let me So I'm sorry for that. Your your parallel execution is not supported on my system using your Firefox because there's some system configuration problem, so which is not getting fixed. So what we are going to do is you guys can take the same code and try to run it on your system and it should work perfectly fine. All right. So what we are going to do is we are going to just, run this testng.xml file on your Google Chrome. So it works perfectly fine. So try the same, okay, on your system and will work. So we'll see what we have covered in your parallel testing. So in your parallel testing, we saw what are the situations that we have to work with parallel testing. When you have to perform multiple execution on your different browsers, we go with your parallel testing, right? So here you have the methods that we have created on the same lines. You just have to run your test and this is how it would work for you. All right. So along with which we have already discussed about your report. So your testng is basically used for reporting purpose along with the annotations that it provides. So it helps you to identify the status of your test case and it will help you to find the bugs that is present in your code as well. So you can share your reports with your managers, your stakeholders, whoever. So these are the features of your report, trackability, traceability, and these are the different types of reports that you encounter. One is your console reports, that is the reports which is displayed on your console. The next one is your HTML reports. And the third one is your XML reports, which we have already seen. So you would be able to find all the different types of reports here, right? So this is what we already discussed, right? So with this, we have to discuss about another, important concept. So that is nothing but your assertion or verification. So it is very important for a test engineer to verify the test scripts, whether it is actually working as per his expectation or not. So for this, what we are going to do is we have already seen how do we verify. We were verifying it using your if and else statement, right? So here we are not going to use your if and else statement. Instead, we are going to use something called as assert class, which helps you to assert the values based on your requirement. So let me show you here what I've taken is I've just copy pasted the code which we had, so which will log into the application and it will once after it logs into the application we are going to assert the title, right? So how do we assert the title? So let me show you. Once we log into this application, so we are going to fetch the title from the application and check whether this is the page that we actually wanted. Okay, so let me log in first. So yes, it is clicking on login. It is logged in successfully. Now what I do, I just inspect this and I'm going to fetch this title from this particular page, right? So let me copy this. Now, how do I assert? I'm going to use a class called assert. But before that, we are going to fetch the title. So for that, I'm going to use this WebDriver wait to wait until the page has been loaded. WebDriver wait is equal to new WebDriver wait and then driver and the timeout in sec. I say wait dot until what it is expected conditions dot title contains. Okay, I'm not going to give complete title. I'm going to give only half of the title. Okay, and I'm going to check whether it is going to that title or not. So once it goes to that title, okay, once it goes to that page, I'm going to capture the title of that page. So what do I do? String title is equal to driver dot get title, right? So this is how we capture the title. So get title. So once it captures the title, here our assertion comes into picture. Assert dot assert equals, okay, what you're going to do is you're going to provide this title, actual title that you have have retrieved from the title that you have considered, right? The title which you have fetched from your application. So what your assert equals does, if the application has launched properly or if you have navigated to the proper page, then it is going to pass your test case, else it is going to fail your test case. So let me run this program. It has logged in and now it is going to check for your title. So once your title is right, it is going to pass your test case, right? If the title is a little wrong, then it is going to fail your test case. So likewise, in your assert class, you have other methods like assert dot assert not equals, all right? So you have it here, assert. If you see, you have not equals, okay? And you can actually compare to object, along with which you can also compare, you can also use this assert to fail your test case, okay? If you say assert.fail, then it is going to fail your test case, okay? And you have something called as assert.assertTrue. Okay, so you have assert true. If you want to provide any condition, you can provide the condition here. Okay, whether you want to make it as true or not, you want to make it as true or false. Okay, and you have something called as assert.false as well. So you can assert it to false. Okay, so likewise, using this assert class, you can start verifying your test case, which will help you to execute your test cases, and it will also help you to recover from any recovery failure while you run your framework. All right, so this is nothing but our assertion and verification. So if you have any questions before, you know, talking about the questions, we'll discuss whatever we have seen till now, right? So we have seen what are the different types of annotations are there and how do we execute it, and what we are going to see is we have also seen what are the groups that you can create and how you can work with your groups, and you can see the sequence of executing the test cases, parameterization, parallel testing, and the different types of reports that gets generated with your test engine, right? So then if you have any questions, you can get back to us, you can drop an email and then call to our support team if you want to get it fixed sooner. And before you come back to your next class, I request you to practice whatever has been done in today's class so that you will have a good hands-on in the next concept that we are going to discuss. So here we have a request. Please do take our survey. So your feedback is very important for us. Your comments, your complaints, your suggestions, your ideas, whatever it is, we are free for it. We will take it and we'll improvise the next time we perform, you know, the sessions for you. So until then, until we meet for the next class, see you guys. Have a good day. Bye-bye.